So reward of the good and faithful servant. In the abundance of your grace, forgive their sins, and remember on your heavenly altar all the good things they once offered to you. May they share in the reward of all your saints with them. May we raise glory and thanks to you forever.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
to the end of this song.
Before the proclamation of the gospel of our Savior announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord.
Peace be with you.
Gospel
of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Luke, who proclaimed life to the world. Let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Remain silent, O listeners. The Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. Listen and give glory and thanks to the word of the living God.
The Lord Jesus said, "Who then is the faithful and prudent steward whom the master will put in charge of his servants to distribute the food allowance at the proper time? Blessed is that servant whom his master on arrival finds doing so. Truly I say to you, he will put him in charge of all his property. But if that servant says to himself, 'My master is delayed in coming,' and he begins to beat the men servants and the maid servants, and to eat and to drink and to get drunk, then that servant's master will come on an unexpected day and an hour unknown and will punish him severely and assign him a place with the unfaithful. That servant who knew his master's will but did not make preparations nor act in accord with his will shall be beaten severely. And the servant who is ignorant of his master's will but acted in a way deserving of a severe beating, shall be beaten only lightly. Much shall be required of the person entrusted with much, and still more will be demanded from the person entrusted with more." This is the truth. Peace be with you.
Praise and blessings to Jesus Christ.
Whosoever much is given, of him much shall be required. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. This gospel is a bit shocking because what we commemorate this week as we enter into the three preliminary weeks before the great fast. So we commemorate the dead. In commemorating the priest, of course, we pray for, and we honor, in a certain sense, obviously also, the priesthood of our Lord within his church. So when we look at this gospel, it's about unfaithful servants being beaten, unexpected, being drunk, abusing other people, and you're thinking, well, why is this gospel chosen? The unfaithful priest, well, they're in hell. The faithful priest we honor, and we pray that they enter into the fullness of the kingdom. So why this gospel is chosen again is to read the whole context. And as always, I encourage you to go back and read. This is chapter 12 of St. Luke. And the chapter is about, which begins by our Lord by saying, "Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees," using baking, putting that little bit in which causes the entire loaf to rise. So our Lord uses this image on the idea of influence, of doctrine, of actions, and how it's the small things that we do which influence not only our own lives in many, many details from one little tiny thing we did, but also influences our family, influences our community, and ultimately on the supernatural level, influences the church, the body of Christ. And so our Lord is making clear that you, my disciples, must live what you actually claim to believe. And this is what he means by being watchful, being awake, being conscious. And that's what this whole chapter is about, being watchful. It doesn't mean watchful in the sense that we're waiting for the day of judgment and the end of the world. But it means that we have the watchfulness to know that our Lord is present, and that that day of judgment will just be the definitive presence. And so our Lord says that you must have your tunics girded up, gird your loins, which means to pull up your clothing, have your legs free, ready to go, ready to move, and have your lamps burning, that you are ready, and that your life should be lived in this way of conscious wakefulness. And so he gives this parable, and at the end of that, he winds up saying, for where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So when we speak about watchfulness, it's actually an examination of what do I love? What am I attached to? Where, in my moments of kind of daydreaming, where does my mind go? What do I look forward to? And that's why our Lord says that where your treasure is, you will know what you are attached to, and you will know what you love, because your heart will be present there. That will be your treasure. It's what you put your value on. When we say the word appreciation, the original Latin word means to put a price on, precium, to put a value on something. When we say we appreciate, we value this. And our Lord is just simply saying that as you work towards conscious living and being watchful, look to your affections, because your heart will indicate to you what you actually treasure. And so at the end of this parable, in chapter 12, St. Peter, always the practical man, comes up to our Lord and he says, is that parable for us, the disciples, the apostles, or is it for everybody that's in this crowd? And then our Lord goes into today's parable. He continues with this chapter. And of course, the famous one by saying, now he's not talking just about those who have been entrusted with things, but now those who hold the position of the king, of the master. Which is why you notice that when the unfaithful servant here, he beats the other servants because he's in charge. He exercises the authority of the king, of the master within this household. So our Lord doesn't directly answer St. Peter. Clearly, the parable is for all the disciples. They must see and live wakeful and watchful and mindful. But then he tells St. Peter and the other apostles that you have been committed even more. And of course, the parable is going to finish with that famous line, and unto whomsoever much is committed, much is entrusted, much will be demanded. And to the one who has received much, much will be required. He's going to have to answer. Remember last week we talked about the responsibility, the ability to answer for something. This parable in all of chapter 12 applies to all of us. As St. Paul says in his letters, we entered into this world naked, and we leave this world naked. We have a period of time where things are loaned to us. Our physical talents, our qualities, our ability to think and to learn, go to school, keep good professional jobs, whatever it may be. And we are loaned stuff, especially in America. We have food on our tables. We have roofs over our heads. We have transportation. But these are on loan. And somebody else is going to have them after we are gone. So the watchfulness is also the understanding that we are entrusted with things that ultimately do not belong to us. The only thing that we take with our naked corpses into death are the virtues and the qualities and the talents that we have developed because of God's grace. That's all we take with us. But what St. Peter gets an earful in the second parable is, but you have received so much more because you exercise the office of trust from the Master. And so St. Peter gets his answer in this second form of the parable of the unfaithful steward. But you'll notice that what happens in this, and this is applicable to all of us, is that he says, the servant says to himself, my master is taking a heck of a long time to get back. So this is good. It's going to be September. We have summertime to party. And so he opens the pantry, he abuses everyone else, makes them do all their jobs, and then he just dives into all of the drink himself. That's what we're given to understand in the parable. But what is interesting to say is that our Lord doesn't say that the master comes unexpectedly, but he says because he acts in this way, the master comes unexpectedly. He does not know the hour or the day. It is the attitude of the chief steward which in part makes the fact that he is ignorant and unexpecting of when he's actually going to show up. In our prayers in the church, we pray from an unprovided death, an unforeseen death, spare us, O Lord. People are like, oh, well, I hope that I get by a car and it's quick. That is like the worst possible death that you could possibly imagine. How many of us are actually watchful and wakeful at every moment? And that our minds and our treasure is truly on the things of God so that I can be smacked by a car and just enter into the fullness of the kingdom. Not me. Most of us are thinking about how this person on the road this morning was an idiot, driving in to do these chores or these errands or go to work, or how this colleague said that, or how my spouse said this to me last night. That's where our minds are. We're distracted all the time. And you'll notice that in this parable, what our Lord is saying is that for the chief steward, the master returns at an unknown day and an unknown hour, because he's not even disposed to receive the master anyway. And that's why this whole chapter begins by saying, have your loins girded and your lamps burning and be always prepared. In Latin, we use the term memento mori. Remember death. It's the only thing which is guaranteed to us. We know that we will all die. It's not a morbid thought. It's to make a value of our lives by understanding that they have a purpose here and now, and not just bobbing along. And so at the end of this whole parable, what our Lord is reminding St. Peter is, you've received a lot of trust, and much has been given to you, and much is going to be required from you. You're going to have to answer for it. So that's why this is chosen out of this week of the commemoration of the dead priests. In the bulletin, I've written up why we also do this, but it's no reason to go into the sermon because it's in the bulletin. But the very following line, which I include in parentheses, because it's not actually part of the gospel read today, the very next line says, and I have come to cast fire upon the earth. Would that it be enkindled. I want this conflagration. This is kind of horrifying at first. What is our Lord talking about? Well, he's talking about an aspect, of course, of divine charity. I desire that the fire of the divine love be enkindled. But to leave you with the sermon today, all of this actually is part of the third luminous mystery of the Rosary. Recent in the history of the mysteries of the rosaries, of the rosary, excuse me, but of course ancient from the gospel. The proclamation of the kingdom, the announcing of the gospel, is a purification and a refining, which is a fire. This is what our Lord is saying by talking about the responsibility of the disciples who are with him, those who will be committed even greater peril in that household, and this fire which is cast out, which is to purify and bring all of mankind ultimately into the kingdom of God. It's purifying, as the scriptures use of the image of gold and silver. You take the smashed rocks from the mine, which is all the ore, that has gold and silver in it, but all of it is cast into a furnace at super high heat, so that the metal will melt out of the rock, because the metal will melt before the stone does. And so you've overheated in this furnace, and the gold and the silver flow out, purified from the dross. Scriptures use this image of how God works to purify souls. And so in this parable of watchfulness and wakefulness, this is the attitude that we as disciples within the kingdom that is being preached, within the gospel, that we desire this fire, not because it may hurt at times, but because we know that the hand of God is infinite charity. And we know that this fire ultimately is meant to purify and to make us holy and to make us like the Hidden One. And for that we are grateful. And for that we ask for a great amount of fidelity, consciousness, being watchful, so that our Lord at his return will always find us with lamps burning and in expectation of the beauty of the eternal light. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We believe in one God, Father.
Amen.
Shower your spiritual blessings upon them in place of their earthly gifts. Grant them life and your kingdom.
Amen.
As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, Saints Mary and Saint Jude and Saint Charbel. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom the sacrifice is offered, for the intentions of all the members of this parish. Remember also all those who share with us today this offering.
Spirit.
grace of the Lord with reverence and worship him with humility.
In his right and just.
With heart, mind, and tongue we give you thanks, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one true God. Join spirit and elite in the invisible choirs and countless ranks of angels. Your faithful people glorify you, and with them three times proclaim.
We praise you, we bless you, we adore you.
spread the body of Christ, our blood.
Amen.
And make the mixture in this chalice the blood of Christ, our God.
Amen.
These holy mysteries, O Lord, allow us to share them to find joy in your presence. And we raise glory to you now and forever.
Thank you.
O Lord, open our mouths and lips, sanctify our bodies and souls, and purify our minds and consciences, so that we may call upon you, O Father of mercies, and implore you, pray, Our Father,
who art in heaven,
I sensed his breath.
body and blood of your only Son. Through him and with him, glory, power, and honor are due to you and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
O Christ, you are the heavenly bread who came down and became for us the food that does not perish. At your second coming, may we not become the food of the imperishable fire. We raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Go in peace. Actually, there's a few announcements. Note that the Maronite Voice is here for this month, so please take a copy today. Please don't bring back last month's Maronite Voices. Somehow they miraculously appear after 6 weeks. So instead of you throwing them away, I throw them away here. So if you could just throw them away at home, that would be great. And I note this coming week on Tuesday, we have the Feast of St. Sergius, who was a Pope of Rome. He is actually a Syriac Antiochene family. And the next week's bulletin will mention it, the four or five different popes that we've actually had who were Syrians, who were Syriac backgrounds. But just to note this coming week during the commemoration of the priesthood on Tuesday is St. Sergius. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.